Alright, so today we are going to continue our discussion on microprocessor design, and the topic today is consistent with the song that we play. It's I Guess I Just Feel Like, and there is a reason for that. And before we start, it's always a good idea that we start with the big picture. So when we talk about the big picture in computer architecture, what was that? Von Neumann architecture, right? You also see this guy, John von Neumann, in our new opening video, right? And this time I have the full body of it, so you know how tall John von Neumann is, but well, I don't know how tall he is, but you can definitely see the computer after him is such a big guy, right? So it's kind of like amazing, isn't that amazing, right? In the past, that's a single computer, and right now a single computer can be this small. Right, but no matter it's a big one or a small one, it's all von Neumann architecture in a way that the computer has the three types of main components, and they are the must in modern computers. So your processor must have a processor, you must have a memory, you must have a persistent storage. And whenever you want to run a program, you have the program first store in a storage, right? Thinking about your PS5 or your Nintendo Switch, right? You have to download that game from somewhere into that particular game console. It's a computer still, right? And when you want to load it, when you want to execute it, you select it from the console, right? If you want to play Zelda, I guess a lot of you did that over the weekend, right? I don't want to tell you too much about my weekend life, but you know, I'm not too different from other people. So the thing is that, right, you load a game from the persistent storage, typically in Nintendo Switch, is a flash, and then load it to the memory of the Switch computer, and then the processor will fetch the instruction, for example, the first part of the Zelda, right? And then you load the instruction, and then you look over what the instruction wants us to, for example, load a picture, something like that, right? And then if we figure out that the instruction really wants us to load a picture, that's the time that you have to load data. So, and once you're done with the picture loading, you will do the next thing, right? So that's the typical execution flow. And as you can hear, there are several things that you have to do for each instruction. So first of all, don't forget you have to always fetch an instruction from the memory. Otherwise, we have no idea what it is, right? Because we are not psychic Taylor, right? So we don't know what was that. And then after getting that instruction, you have to decode it so you know what exactly the instruction wants us to do, as well as you need to prepare the values that the instruction needs. And then you execute the context of the instruction. Depending on what kind of instruction it is, it could either be performing ALU operations like subtraction, addition, multiplication, or divide. Or it may be a branch instruction. By branch, it means that it's an instruction that will change the control flow or say execution flow of your program. And we need something to judge if we want to change that flow. So if we have to change the flow, which means that you are not executing the instruction right next to the current one, it's a taken branch, otherwise it's a not taken branch. And the memory instruction are those instructions who will interact with memory. And that's also the instruction that needs a separate ALU, separate unit, to be honest. And that separate unit will perform address calculation, and then use the calculated result. We will send a request to the memory controller. So that's why there is a data memory access stage. And particularly, you can consider this is the stage that your processor will interact with your data cache. And finally, there is a write back stage, which will reflect your execution result to a set of internal registers in your processor so that the follow-up instruction can use that. However, you know, if you don't change this particular thing, we typically forget about this, right? Update PC. If you don't update your PC, you will just stay in the same instruction again, again, and again, which is not meaningful at all. So you have to update the PC, and again, if the branch is taken, set the PC to the taken address. Otherwise, just go to the next PC. And in modern instruction set architecture, for example, like MIPS or RISC-V or any instruction set architecture has fixed length of instruction, it's 4 byte wide, so it's PC plus 4. However, for this class in particular, we are using SID6, which an instruction can be as short as 1 byte as long as 17 bytes. So it's just the next PC. All right. So so we know there are so many things to do. So the naive implementation of the processor would want to do everything within a cycle. So when the cycle starts, your instruction will go through every necessary data path elements for the instruction. And then once you finish that, you will have the next instruction. Well, so this architecture works, but you can immediately find that, well, at the end of the cycle, even though a lot of functional units or data path elements are not in use, it's still consuming power, it's still active. So that's not very economic. In fact, it also hurts, it also wastes a lot of opportunities for further performance optimization. So modern computer architectures, almost every processor is now a pipeline processor in a way that in the beginning of the cycle, instead of having your instruction going all the way to the end of the data path, we only go to one step. And then in a when the next cycle comes, we advance the current instruction to the next step and have another one using the step that you freed up. So if you gradually execute instructions in this way, you will see that you will have your processor, every component in your processor is busy working on something. So in this way, you better utilize your hardware as well as improve the instruction level parallelism in your execution, making your performance better. So that's the idea of pipelining, and pipelining is right now universal in every processor design. And however, the idea of pipelining is that ideally after some point, because every cycle, every hardware component is working on something, including the hardware components of delivering the result. So it turns out that after some point, you are completing an instruction each cycle, and the CPI is equal to 1, which is identical to the original design. And the better thing is that because in each cycle time, you only need to advance an instruction to a short step instead of a complete data path. So your cycle time could be a lot shorter. So don't forget our performance equation, instruction count times CPI times cycle time. So in this way, instruction count remains the same. CPI is also 1, but the cycle time is a lot shorter. So that's why pipeline can help improve performance. However, the world is not perfect in a way that, okay, there are three types of hazard: structural hazard, data hazard, control hazard, right? And in the last lecture, we talked about stall is the universal solution that can solve all types of hazard. But if you want to use it to address the structural hazard that we have, you can see for this particular 7 instructions, we have to stall for sub-5 cycles, which is not great and almost a waste of the hardware resource we have. So a better design is to anything regarding structural hazard. The best solution is always that you have to look into your hardware design to see if you can improve that. So one of the default design we have is that for the register file access, we separate the register file access into half cycles. So the first half cycles, we allow the write to happen. And the second half of the cycle, we allow read to happen. So in this way, if there are two instructions, one want to write, the other one to read, there won't be conflict. So turns out that we will address the structural hazard. And a lot of you, which I didn't tell you, but a lot of you already find that when you are doing the assignment that my processor has two separate types of cache, instruction cache and data cache. And again, the reason is if you don't have a split cache, then an instruction wants to fetch the instruction and the other one wants to access the data, and there will be structural hazard. And sometimes if there is a mess, it takes sufficient amount of time. So the best design is, the better design is to split the L1 cache so you can guarantee the instruction supply, which has better locality, can be very smooth. So that's the common design you will see in modern processor to address the structural hazard. And today we are going to talk another type of hazard. But before we start, I have a question for you to brainstorm for 3 minutes together with your friends. What will you do if you are not sure about an answer in exams? You must have a lot of experience with this, right? So go.
Hello.
Hello.
Do you want
art? Yeah.
Oh,
your thoughts about how to address the issue? Like, this is very realistic, right? I did that. I didn't do that a lot, but like sometimes you just might want to know, like, okay, I really don't know the answer then, but I really need to put an answer then. What are you going to do? Does that happen to you, Scott?
I did a lot of what Jordan already mentioned, where I eliminate mm-hmm. some of the answers that I...
How do you eliminate?
Well, I can try to pick out some things that I know are wrong.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. What else? You don't look like Aaron. Okay, Aaron version 2, what do you think?
Eliminate.
Okay, Andy, what do you think?
I will just skip that hard question.
Skip the hard question and then?
Think about it later.
But what if you really cannot get an answer then? Go maybe the wrong answer. Okay, what else? Ryan, what do you think? If you don't know anything, or you know something.
Just do something.
Just do something?
Well, yeah, just take, I mean, it's better than leaving it blank.
Okay, better than leaving it blank. Just write something, right? Okay, so here are some of the answer, right? That I would got. I was hoping to hear that you guys can be more honest, to be honest, right? So guess, right? Just guess, right? Just guess, right? Like, and how to guess, right? Some of you would do random guess, right? Just so that's why sometimes we have a pencil. It's not because we want to write things, just because pencil would give you 6 options to guess, right? Yeah, so that's why we need a pencil, right? And also some of you will think about, huh, I have a sufficient amount of A, but I don't see C, right? Why don't I put a C, right? I know a lot of people like to do that, so that's why I don't have C in multiple choice answers, because, okay, anyway. So next time, if you are making a choice of C in my test, be careful about it. It's very unlikely that's true. Anyway, all right, so, just guess, right? Because there's no harm if there is no penalty of putting the wrong answer, right? So that's connected to our lecture today. So what are we going to talk about today is to address the control hazard. And then the best way to address control hazard is through dynamic branch prediction, which is basically guess. And you can probably learn how to guess from the strategy that dynamic branch prediction has. All right, but before we start, what is control hazard? Right, control hazard is the case where we don't know what's the next instruction to fetch because an instruction, for example, a branch instruction or a conditional jump instruction may change the execution flow of your program. So if you keep fetching the next instruction, you will lead to incorrect outcome. So that's why we typically have to stall until we resolve that branch to continue execution. And because this is a pipeline processor, as long as you stop fetching, you are effectively waste a cycle of generating outputs. So that's a problem, right? So you might think, okay, how often am I going to meet a branch? So here is the code. What it looks like. And so this is a loop this is a loop that we have seen before, right? Like in the demo code. I have an array. I try to see how many data is larger than the threshold, and I try to get a summation from it, right? So that's the code that you have seen before, and you might have a code that is similar to that. And as you can see, well, it seems like this is a very simple structure, but within this structure, you already see whenever you have a condition, whenever you might have to, whenever you want to implement a loop, whenever you have a statement that you have to judge, there is a branch. So if you look at this, right? So here we have J small, that smaller than reps, repeats, right? And then you can see that, okay, here, the label at L. So typically, if you want to dive into the assembly code, when you see this assembly code, it's typically you will see a label. And then start with the label, there will be some instruction. And then until the instruction, and then you will see there is some kind of instruction like JL, right? So this JL is means jump less than, right? So for this jump less than instruction is that, okay, I did this comparison, if it's smaller, then I jump to, and then I will jump to L6 or something, right? So that's a branch, right? Otherwise, typically you would just force through. And in the terminology of compilers, for instruction that's there is a terminology called basic blocks. Oops. What happened? Okay, lovely. Okay, so typically, in compiler, there is a terminology called basic block. Means the first through is execution until you reach a branch. So you can, and the reason why it called basic block is that, because for this yellow box, this three instruction, they will always be executed together, right? Because you don't change the execution flow until you reach the branch. So that's a basic block. So you can see, right, typically a statement like this is a single basic block. And then if it's smaller, then I would jump back. You might wonder why it's jump back. And don't forget, right, for this particular one, you are implementing a loop. So a loop means that, okay, after I reach the end, I have to go back. So that's why you have a backward branch. So whenever you see a branch instruction which change the direction of execution to an instruction that is earlier. So for example, here we go back to L6, which is earlier, then it's a backward branch, right? And if you look at this one, so this one, I smaller than size. So similarly, right? Their implementation here is a little bit different. So here we jump less, and here we do jump greater, JG, right? So if it's greater, we go to L4, right? Oh, sorry, so this is actually wrong. Because if it's greater and equal, then this is probably this one, right? So here you can see this is an example of forward branch. This is an example of forward branch, because for this one, you are jumping to an instruction that is after this branch instruction. So this is called a forward branch. So there are two types of branch, backward branch and forward branch. And typically, if you are implementing a loop, that's a backward branch. And you will see forward branch if you have an if statement. So that's typically what the code is, the code implementation looks like. Okay, looks like I have to do it. Let me see. Before I jump into the question, some of you might be curious about, okay, how do I get such kind of S86 assembly? So if you pay attention to our assignment before, you might already know that you can easily do it through GCC. And, hello, okay. Let me see. So for example, this is exactly the loop.c that I show you, right? So it has this, and you can use GCC-S. And if you do -O0, you will see, whoa, I generated a lot of instructions, pretty much like what I have shown you, JGL4, right? And the reason why I show That longer version is because for a -0 there is no optimization, so the code is easier to understand, although it's more wordy. However, the compiler can do a lot of optimizations. So for example, constant propagation, or they can, if they know some of the smart compiler, right, like the code that I just showed you, because the threshold is not changing, and you are doing the same thing for the same iteration of J. So they can just do one loop and times the amount of sum you get. So that kind of optimization could greatly shorten the code that you have. So for example, like, okay, the same loop, right, which take a lot of number of instructions now, is only this long after the optimization. It's only this long. Did you see that? Did you see that? Because they realized that a lot of ops, you don't have to do it. So the whole point here is that if you want to see how your programs are implemented into S86 instruction, that's the best way. Okay, so now I want to ask you about, okay, you know there are two types of branch, and because of those branch, we don't know if we are going forward or going backward. So, but the thing is that why we have to stall without being able to do anything? All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so. Okay, normal distribution, right? Very good evidence that you guys are guessing. So why don't you discuss with others to see if the two that you are thinking are consistent with the other two that others are thinking. Go!
Hello. 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 Hello.
All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, so looking at your answers, okay, we definitely need some discussion. So why don't you go ahead and discuss with your friends? Go! All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, what do you guys think? C, okay. Is this based on branch prediction? Yes, okay. So, how do you guess?
I said that the if statement is always gonna be wrong, but the while loop was gonna be right 99% of the time.
So this right 99% of the time, but this one you said it's always going to be wrong?
Yes.
Okay, Ryan, you shake your head. So what do you think?
It's because of the first prediction is gonna be not taken, so it's gonna go not taken. The second one is also not taken, so it's gonna bounce around between 00 and 01, so it's gonna guess 50% of the time right.
Okay, so this is 50% of the time right.
That's what I said.
What?
That's what I said.
That's what you said?
Just
that.
Just the first branch. So do we just average it?
What do you think? What do you guys? Do you guys agree with each other now? No, that's not the reason.
I'm not sure.
You're not sure now.
But yeah, that's what I thought.
Okay. What do you, what others would think? Yes? You think Ryan is right? Okay. Mm-hmm.
For branch X, I got the same thing.
Okay, you got the same thing, right? Okay.
Awesome. All right. So if you don't believe, okay. So that's so we have two groups, right? So if you look at the bar, C is the most popular answer, but apparently, what's your name, by the way?
Jonathan.
Okay. Apparently, Jonathan and Ryan, they have other thoughts, right? They have other thoughts. Okay. So that's why you need to come to school, because the IT support at the school is not really good. Okay. Again, I hate this microphone, by the way. Okay. So here's the thing, right? So most of the time, you can make an easy analysis, right? But if you really want to know the detail, right, it doesn't hurt to just run through it, right? So for this particular one, now, when I am here, right, the I, because I haven't incremented, so the I is currently 0. Here, I'm doing 0 mod 2. Who can fix this microphone for me? All right. So right now, 0 mod 2 is equal to 0 or not?
Yes,
right? So it is 0. Okay. And here, I would say, the branch is taken if it's 0. And I didn't come up with this imaginary. It's the true implementation. So for this particular branch, if I mod 2 is equal to 0, it means that you are not going to do this, so you will jump to the next instruction. So that's why previously when people think about if something is true, then it's a taken one. But now for this particular one, I can tell you if it's true, then it's not taken because you are going to execute the next instruction. So for this one, if it's not true, then it's a taken branch. So the first one, right, it's a branch X, and currently the state is 00, right? Because everything here, I assume for this particular question, it starts with 00. So am I going to predict taken or not taken, Jonathan?
Not taken.
Not taken, right? Is the actual outcome taken or not taken?
Taken.
Taken, right? So this time we guess it wrong. Okay, now, the program keeps executing, then I reach Y, right? So this is branch Y. So currently it's 00. A lot of you know it's not taken, but the actual outcome is taken because we are going back again, right? So this, I think, is easy to understand. Now the next one, when I meet branch X, the I is 1. So this time, because previously it's actually taken, so set your counter to 01. Do I predict taken or not taken? Not taken. Not taken? Agree? Not taken, right? Is the actual outcome? Not sure. What's the definition of not taken? Not sure about that. Okay. So for this one, taken means what? Okay, you didn't listen to it. Okay, so, okay, here's the thing, right? You're here, so pay attention to the class, all right? And although we tried our best to record everything, but as you can just feel, right, the microphone is not always working. The wireless connection is not very well, unfortunately. So there are a lot of things that I cannot accommodate. A lot of you were asking about, like, where is the missing recording? I can just tell you, it's just lost, right? If you don't hear anything on YouTube, if I don't put anything on YouTube, it's not because I didn't do it, it's just because we don't have it anymore, right? So sometimes that would happen. So it's very valuable for you to pay attention to the class. I'm still glad that you come here, right? Because sometimes if you experience it, you will know it. So for this particular case, right, we said branch S is taken if I mod 2 equal to 0. Right, so for this case, now my I equal to 1. So is it taken or not taken? given it's taken, if I mod 2 equal to 0, now your I is equal to 1. Is it taken or not taken?
Not taken.
Not taken, right? So the actual outcome is not taken. So how am I going to move my state? Decrement it, right? So the next time you meet branch X, the state will be 0, 0. Right? So branch Y, I keep incrementing it, but you can finish the table yourself. And then you will know 50% of the time, right? I would guess the X wrong, right? So that's why you get, for X, X is 50%. For Y, you almost get 100%. So it's close to 75. Okay, so be careful when you are, so there's a reason I put those question here. I'm not just putting this question here for fun. Right, they have their own meanings in the class. Right, pay attention to those. And for this particular question, I just want to show you, depending on what kind of branch you are dealing with, the too big predictor doesn't always work. Right, in this case, it can only get 50% of the accuracy. Okay, so now 75. If you got 75 in your midterm, are you satisfied? Yeah. Yes? Okay. Then we can jump to data hazard now. If you are not satisfied, okay, if you are not satisfied, then we can continue. So can we do a better job? So it comes with this paper that I think is in assigned reading by Yopet. You might already see who Yopet is in our opening video, right? It's called two-level global predictor. So the idea of global predictor is that, okay, here, right? If you do the training locally, you will feel like this X, right? It's hard to predict because it's sometimes taken, sometimes not taken, right? But if you look at the actual execution of all those X and Ys, you will find that, if I look at this row, right, it's always like NT, TTT, NT, TTT, NT, TTT, right? I feel like I'm in a music class, right? It's always not taken, 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 not taken, 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 not taken, 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 taken. Okay, right, it's always this pattern. So here comes with the idea. Instead of training the states locally, can I leverage the fact that there is a pattern in the execution outcome to make a prediction? Right, so this is pretty much the idea that, like the idea that you guys would like, right? If you see the multiple choice question, it's always like, after you look at the first 8 questions, right, you see it's always B, C, A, B. What's your intuition for the answer to 9 to 12? B, C, A, B, right? So the thing is like, okay, can we make a prediction based on this kind of observation? So here we come with the idea of global history predictor. So the idea of global history predictor is like this. So first of all, because right now we don't make prediction on each branch's outcome. Instead, we only look into the outcome of all branches. So we have to make a small modification in a branch target buffer in a way that we get rid of the state column. We only record the branch and its target. So it's the real branch target buffer now. It only has the branch instruction and its target. Okay, so the prediction part looks like this. So first of all, saying that right now, I create this predictor that I make prediction based on the last 4 execution outcome of your branch. So I need 4 bits of the register, right? So 0, 1, 0, 0 means that it's not taken, taken,
not taken, right? So that's the global history register. Okay. In the meantime, I maintain another table, right? It's the state associated with the history. And if you have 4-bit, you are going to have 2 to the 4, a total of 16 different branch patterns, right? So you can easily imagine this would be representing 000, and this would be representing 1111. And right now, I am at 0100. So it's actually 0100. It's actually this one, right? This is 0100, right? So how can I make a prediction? First, I use a branch target buffer to figure out the target PC. In the meantime, I use the global history register to figure out, for this particular pattern, what was its state. And in this particular one, it says 10. So we can use the same saturated counter idea, right? If the last time you see this pattern, it is a taken, then I incremented the counter. If the last time I see this pattern and the next one is not taken, then I decrement the counter. And the current value here is 10, so it's predict taken, right? So I would move my program counter to the target address, right? So that's the branch target buffer, the global history predictor. So for this particular question that the 2-bit predictor didn't do well, let's use a global history predictor to see how it can do. So first of all, again, I equal to 0. Right? So it's right now at branch X. And let's start with 00. Let's say we have 3 bits only to shorten the discussion. So the state is right now, if everything starts with 00, right? Then predict taken or not taken? Not taken. Is the actual outcome taken or not taken? It's taken, right? So I guess it's wrong, right? But the next time, if I see this pattern, right, I would change the state to 01, right? Remember this, right? So now, I still equal to 0, well, actually equal to 1. Okay, there's a typo here. So when I equal to 1, the branch Y, okay, so now, because the last branch is taken, right? So I change my history register now to 001. Right, because the last branch is taken. Do I ever see this pattern before? Not at all, right? So the state is still 00. Predict taken or not taken? Not taken, right? Is the actual outcome taken or not taken? Taken. I still guess it wrong. Okay, now I equal to 1 when I'm at X. What's the current history register? 011, right? Because the last one is still a taken, right? So it's 011, right? I didn't see this pattern before. So what's the state? 00. Predict taken or not taken? Not taken. Is the actual outcome taken or not taken? Not taken. Okay, so the next time when I see 011, its state will be 00, right? Because the last time is not taken. Now, what's my GHR the next time I execute any branch? 110, right? 110. Okay, so now I incremented it.
So it's 2, right?
And it's branch X, branch Y, and it's going to be 110. Do I have this pattern before? No, right? 00, not taken. The actual outcome is? Taken or not taken? Taken. Okay, so far you feel like this predictor sucks, right? It gets almost wrong for everything. Be patient. Okay, so now when I equal to 2, when I'm at branch X, what's my current pattern? 101. Have I ever seen this pattern before? Not at all. 00, not taken. Is the actual outcome taken or not taken? Taken. I'm losing my passion now, right? It's not working. Be patient. Be patient. Okay, now, incremented I.
So it's 3. And?
Branch Y. What's my current history?
011. Have I seen 011
somewhere before? Yes. Okay, but the last time it's not taken, so it's still 00, right? Predict not taken. The actual outcome is still taken. Okay, it's not right, but you know the next time it will be 01, right? Okay, so now going to 3x. What's the GHR?
111.
00, not taken. Not taken. Right?
But you know, this is just like good luck. Right? This branch predictor is not really working. Okay, why Yelpad write a paper on this? Right?
Now,
I equal to 4 at branch Y. What's my current history? 110. Do I ever see 110 before? Yes, here, right? So the last time the execution was taken. So right now my state will be 01.
Still predict not taken. Is the actual outcome taken or not taken? Taken. See? Still not working. Okay. I don't believe you, professor. Why are you teaching me this junk? Be patient. Be patient. Sometimes good things are happening later. Right? Okay. I equal to 4x. What's my current history? 101. Have I ever seen 101 somewhere before? Yes.
It's right here. What's the state now?
01, because the previous execution was a taken, right? I predict not taken still, but it's actually taken. But do you feel that something is changing? It's changing, right? Be patient, right? Now,
I'm advancing I to 5. I'm at Y. What's my current history?
011. Have I seen 011 before?
Yes, right. And now, what's the state of it?
01. Still predict not taken, actual outcome taken. But you see, there is something starting to change, right? Starting to change. Okay. Now, I equal to 5. I'm at X. What's my current history?
111, right?
So, have I ever seen 111 before?
Yes. What was the state now?
00, because the previous execution was not taken. So I'm predicting not taken, still not taken. Right? Okay. Now,
advance to 6. I'm at Y. What's my current history? 110. Have I ever seen 110 before?
Yes.
What's my current state of 110?
1.
Predict taken or not taken?
Taken. Is the actual outcome taken or not taken? Taken. Okay. Something start to change. Did you see that? Be patient. Okay. Now, S equal to 6. Branch X. What's my current register?
History register. 101 right here. So 101. Have I ever seen 101 before?
Yes.
So, what's my current state of 101?
10. Predict taken or not taken?
Taken.
Is the actual outcome taken or not taken?
Taken.
Right?
Did you see the change?
Right? Now,
advance it. I equal to 7. Branch Y. What's my current history register? 011. Have I ever seen 011 before?
Yes.
01 is right here. Previously it was taken.
Right? So now it's 10, predict taken, actual outcome taken. Right? Now when I equal to 7, when I meet X,
it's 111. 111, I see it before,
it's 00. Right? So not taken, and the actual outcome is not taken. If you keep going, right, when I equal to 8, I'm at branch 1. I will see 110. Sounds familiar, right? And its state will be now 11. Predict taken, the actual outcome will be taken, right? If you keep going, if you keep going, if you keep going, if you keep going, you'll figure out that after some point, right, all my prediction are accurate. Isn't that a magic? It takes a longer time to train, but the outcome is good, right? So that's the 2-bit global history predictor. And here it's called a global predictor because we don't maintain the per branch state. We are only maintain the state for each history. So this is another extreme of branch prediction. And for this one, it's particularly effective for this particular example. All right, so let's stop our discussion on branch prediction here today, and we are going to continue our discussion this week. And assignment 3 is already up, and a total of 18 questions to answer. I envision that you will need at least 2 days to finish this assignment, so I already tell you everything that you need to know, so please start early. And the midterm, you can pick up outside Winston Cho Hall 4-6 anytime before next Monday. And don't knock my door. Sometimes I'm working inside and you will scare me. And the other thing is that a lot of people find it's difficult to find their exams, and it's already difficult to find now because people already mess up the order. But we do have an order in the very beginning. And the other thing is that that's the office wing, so don't talk too loud because other people are actually having meetings or discussion. So other than that, that's everything you need to know. I will see you on Thursday.
That's just